Good morning, everybody. It's just wonderful to see you all here. Welcome to the Ford Foundation, and welcome to the Just City. It's just great to see so many friends out there. This is the second in a series of gatherings marking the Foundation's 75th anniversary of working with all of you, working with visionary leaders and visionary organizations around the world. These 75th anniversary forums bring together leaders, bring together people like you to explore some of the most important issues we're facing. A few weeks ago, we had an amazing event on the arts. It was filled with magic and surprises, and I think today is going to be the same. And as we've just seen, the issue we're dealing with today, the state of our cities, is a pivotal issue that already, for the first time ever in the history of mankind, touches half the world's population. And these issues will only grow more important. All the growth in population, all that population growth we hear about in China, in India, in Africa, all of it is going to be urban over the next four decades. 2.3 billion people will make urban places their homes. By 2050, 6 billion people, 6 billion people, more than have existed in the history of the world, are going to live at one time in cities. For anyone who cares about social justice, these facts raise urgent questions. Cities end up being the places we have to do the work we do. How will these urban areas, how will they meet the aspirations of all residents, not just the privileged few? How do we ensure that our cities evolve as just cities, shaped by fairness, shared prosperity, and fulfilled aspirations? These people come to these cities with hopes and dreams. How do we ensure that those hopes and dreams are fulfilled? Metropolitan regions are the crossroads of the social justice issues we care about. Jobs, education, housing, transportation, human rights. They're all going to thrive or suffer based on how we manage the future of cities. There is no other work if we can't figure out a way to have these cities work for these people. But tackling these issues is going to require fresh thinking. It demands that we have the courage to reach beyond municipal boundaries, that Bronxville and the Bronx begin to think about one unified regional vision. It demands that we rethink transportation and transportation policy, housing development and land use, so that we don't end up with isolated cities with populations unable to reach where work is, where opportunity is. And it relies on new and innovative partnerships. We have to stop thinking about business and government, cities and national opportunities as different. We have to begin to think about a unified vision, because breaking down these old silos is a requirement if we're going to institute these new generation solutions that you're going to hear about today. Now, I know it won't be easy. A lot of times, I feel like the patron saint of hopeless causes. But I have to tell you that on this topic, I really do have immense optimism. And I'll tell you why. And some of you might know this. I grew up not far from here in the South Bronx. I grew up just a few miles north. It was a different world back then. The South Bronx was a place of hopelessness. And you say that and it sounds dramatic, but I can't tell you how hopeless it was. 40% of the people who lived there had left, and 40% of the housing stock had literally vanished. Landlords who could only fulfill their greed by burning those buildings down had left the community devastated. Today, when I go back, the picture couldn't be more different. I don't see burned out buildings, vacant lots strewn with trash. There are no syringes on the sidewalk. There's no bitter smell from the previous night's fire. What I see is a place where hard-working people struggle. But you know, they send their kids to decent local schools, they shop in vibrant neighborhood commercial centers, and every once in a while, I'm a gardener, every once in a while you even see little gardens being tended to. Today, the South Bronx is the kind of place that we dream of in other places. It's a hard-working community that is sustainable, that is low income, but provides a basic decency of life. And this once imaginable transformation has to remind us of how far we can go to restore cities. Because if we can restore that place, we can restore any place. I know that even the most distressed city, even the place with greatest difficulty today, is a place that can have hope and a future. But it's not going to happen by accident. It's going to require us. It's going to require living cities. It's going to require the NEA. It's going to require a consortium, a broad-based amalgamation of people to work together. So I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for being here. I want to thank you for joining us. I want to thank you for the work so many of you do with us. But most importantly, and think of this as a thanks, but also think of it as a challenge, I want to thank you for the work you're going to do to try to make sure that these cities that are going to absorb 2.3 billion people in the coming few years within our lifetimes, that these cities evolve and grow as just cities, as cities defined by fairness and opportunity, as cities that bring together the aspirations of all their residents, not just the privileged few. So thank you. And with that, let me introduce my buddy over here, someone who many of you know very well, our Vice President for Economic Opportunity and Assets, Pablo Farías. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Luis. That nice introduction lays the vision that has inspired us to bring together this convening today. And I want to thank you, first of all, for joining us today on behalf of the Economic Opportunity and Assets Program staff, and particularly of our Metropolitan Opportunity team that has made this convening together, that has brought you all to share with us this vision and the challenges that we are addressing today in this meeting. Today's discussion is much more than a commemoration of 75 years of work at the Ford Foundation. It's an opportunity to look forward, to take stock together of the new ways in which leaders are tackling pressing challenges and advancing opportunity in our urban communities. This is a critical time, a time when we face the challenge of shaping a vision to guide the growth of our cities into a future of fairness, opportunity, and equity. What we do today will define the character of this new era of urbanization. We at Ford are proud of having supported an illustrious group of partners that shaped a history of innovation on urban issues over many decades. And particularly happy to see some of you here today. As we planned this event, we thought often of the ways in which our predecessors were able to build a movement of urban revitalization that responded to the crisis of segregation and urban conflict in the 1960s. That important work leveraged the achievements of the civil rights movement to generate a whole new field in community development, bringing together community organizers, political leaders, and innovators. They were able to build an enduring platform for neighborhood revitalization, and their achievements are well known for their impact that we feel every day in countless low-income communities throughout the country. Today, we face a new challenge that also calls on us to come together and innovate. In this convening, we will hear from an impressive array of innovators who are reimagining and rebuilding urban regions. Let me try to summarize the core ideas that we see emerging from their new approaches. First, that metropolitan regions play a central role in defining economic opportunity and competitiveness in our globalized markets. Second, that cities can be a central force for democracy, offering a vital space where public life is opened up to everyone and formerly marginalized groups have a voice. And third, that cities are critical engines of creativity and imagination, fostering artistic expression, generating knowledge, and advancing human achievement. We must work together to build these ideas into a new force for urban development. The economic crisis that we confront today requires the same courage and imagination that inspired previous generations of leadership to break the silos of political and social action and generate an era of innovation. Our discussions and presentations today, organized in five outstanding panels, will feature a unique blend of leaders, innovators, and practitioners. We believe that their work, seen together, defines the vision we need to transform urban development for generations. They are creating a new geography of opportunity, one that goes beyond neighborhoods to tap the wealth and power of metropolitan regions and channel the fundamental forces of urban life to promote opportunity for all. So let me turn to our first panel. Together, Bruce Katz, our longtime partner at the Brookings Institution, Kasim Reed, the remarkable mayor of Atlanta, Alejandro Echeverri, the creator behind one of the most astonishing urban and social transformations of recent years in Medellin, Colombia, and Robin Wilner, who at IBM is creating new technology tools to empower communities for full participation in their processes of development. We will examine what defines metropolitan opportunity today. And this conversation will be led by a dear colleague and pioneer in building a vision of equity for our cities, our friend Angela Glover Blackwell. So let me welcome them as I thank you for joining us in this journey. I know that together we can build the partnerships needed for a new generation of leadership in metropolitan opportunity. Welcome to the Just City.